College Program Service of California State University, Living Sims.
The following DHDV Live broadcast is featured as a special presentation of National Distance Learning Week and the United States Distance Learning Association.
Happy Saturday, everybody, and welcome to another edition of TE407 Language Learning. I'm your host, Danny Purcell, coming to you live and online from the beautiful campus of California State University at Dominguez Hills here in bright and sunny Carson, California. As you heard during the opening, Cal State University Dominguez Hills is celebrating National Distance Learning Week. We welcome those of you from around the country to see what we do and hope you will join in our interactive discussion. This is an interactive live program, and it's so much better when we have lots of participation. There are two ways to participate. First of all, feel free to give us a call at 1-800-339-1193 again. 1-800-339-1193, or send us an email at dhtv.csudh.edu, again, dhtv.csudh.edu. Welcome, everybody, who missed you. Very happy to have you today. I'm excited because we're talking about developing students' listening and speaking skills. Last week, we talked about, we called it settling for second best, talking about folks with second language instruction. We discussed the stages of second language acquisition. We discussed characteristics of effective second language instruction. And we talked about how we can best facilitate second language instruction for our ESL students. Next week, we're going to be talking all about reading, which is my biggest passion. Anybody knows me knows I talk all about reading. This past week, I spoke all over the country. I was in Fairfax, Virginia, Murfreesboro, Tennessee, and Asheville, North Carolina, talking about reading with some great folks. I'll tell you what, I think North Carolina, that area of the Smoky Mountains, is just one of the most beautiful spots on the planet, but not as beautiful as here in beautiful Los Angeles, so it's almost perfect here. Why are you even watching? If you're in L.A., why are you watching me right now? Go outside. You will be amazed at all the things you can see and do when you go outside. But if you are stuck in there, I know a lot of parents right now are disciplining their children by making them watch me. Next week, we're going to talk about developing ESL students' reading skills, but this week, we are focused on speaking and listening. So our goals for today, by the end of this session, you will understand the importance of developing ESL students' oracy in English. We'll talk about oracy. It's a fancy educational term. We'll get into English real quick. We'll talk about how to recognize the stages of our ESL students' listening and speaking skills in English. And we'll learn how to understand a variety of ways to promote English language oracy. There's that word again. In your classroom. Okay, so here's our question of the week. Let's hear your responses to this, everybody. How do you encourage your students to speak in your classroom? How do you encourage them to speak English in your classroom? How do you get them to speak any language in your classroom? What are you doing to promote a lot of talk in your classroom? I've said this from day one. You know, Mario Andretti said it. If things are under control, you're just not moving fast enough. And to me, a good classroom is a chaotic classroom. It's a very loud classroom, especially for our ESL students. All students, though, benefit from hearing lots of language all the time. And again, it doesn't matter what the language is. The kids need to be hearing language as much as possible. And for those of you that are parents at home, you need to be speaking to your children as much as possible. And kids are listening from all the time. So again, give us a call at 1-800-339-1193, or you can send in your comments and questions via email at dhtv.csudh.edu. All right, let's get into it. Let's talk about English language oracy development. Let's talk about oracy. Oracy, here's what it means, learning to listen and speak. Oracy, when we're talking about oracy, it's listening and speaking. So let's put that to rest right now. You can stand English. All that good old jargon that we like to use in education. or is in English, so learning to listen and to speak in English makes it possible for students to succeed in school. Now, it's interesting, I was in Asheville, North Carolina the other day, and I was in my hotel exercising on the treadmill, and I was next to a gentleman from St. Louis, Missouri, who was there, and we decided to solve every single problem in the world, so we started talking to each other about some of the problems that we see facing the president, the Congress right now, things to deal with, and he was asking me about my, he was into healthcare, so we talked about healthcare, and I was into education, so we talked about education, and I told him, you know, I've traveled around the country quite extensively this past year speaking, and, you know, the media likes to present America in terms of black and white, that there's real conservatives and real liberals, and in my experience going around this country is most Americans are actually a lot more simple than that. We're pretty much in the middle. You know, we want to feel safe. We want our roads to work. We don't want to pay a ton of taxes. You know, we want our kids to get a good education. We want a secure retirement. And I was telling this gentleman that his name was Danny, and I told Eddie that, you know, I really think that this whole debate that this entire class has been talking about, the debate between English only and bilingual education, I think it's kind of a ridiculous debate, because I think that pretty much all of us can agree, all of us, I think, can agree that if you really want to succeed in America, you pretty much need to know English. I think that is not in dispute. I think even your most extreme liberal people are going to say that, yeah, English is really important. And one of the arguments I've been making all semester is it doesn't really have to be at the expense of a student's primary language. So if the primary language at home is Spanish, or it's Farsi, or it's Korean, that student should be allowed to develop their own first language and at the same time also develop English. And what I argue today is where I see the problem is in America is that we're not putting an emphasis on all kids who are American-born or who have no other language background whatsoever. We have no emphasis in this country pretty much at an early age on those children learning second language. So kids that look like me, you know, can't get any more white Irish American than Danny, you know, kids like me should be having to learn another language starting from kindergarten. It can, you know, I can pick a Spanish track or a Japanese track or whatever the language, Russian. We should all be getting a second language because we know that people are using more of their brains when they have a couple of languages in there. And this guy, who he told me at the beginning of our conversation, he's a very extreme conservative. And I said, well, you know, I think extreme conservatives and extreme liberals, they need to start listening to one another because I don't think they're as extremely a part of a thing if they just actually listen. Today we're talking about listening. Listening is very valuable, folks, because too many of us, we get all caught up in our own opinion. We don't really listen to the other person. And for our ESL students, if you can really help them listen, whatever it takes to help them to listen, I think we move mountains. Let's see. We already got some emails coming in. I'm very excited. We got one from Sonya. Sonya, thank you so much for emailing. Sonya writes, you can encourage students to speak in the classroom through peer interaction activities. Go ahead and write more, Sonya. A lot of classrooms I see, there's teachers that even have like maybe a listening corner, and they'll have maybe audio tapes or allow kids to interact. This is really good, particularly with a lot of teachers that don't speak the primary languages of their students. Well, if you have at least a couple of students in your classroom speaking a similar language, it's great to hear those kids out and let them talk to one another, because, you know, in my experience, a lot of times that quiet kid that doesn't say a whole lot in English because they don't have much English, those ears are open and they're listening. But a good teacher can really encourage that student to come out of their shell by at least encouraging them to communicate in their primary language. This is what's great about teaching, is when we really put our students in a role and get to teach one another and then also teach us. I learned so much from my ESL students because when I started teaching, I had very limited Spanish. And I think I said this a couple of weeks ago in class. I was watching a video of me from 15 years ago teaching my second graders over at Mary Anderson Elementary. I used to do the whole day in Spanish. And this is what was freaky, folks. Is there I am on the video speaking Spanish to my kids, doing the entire class in Spanish, and I couldn't understand a lot of what I was saying. It wasn't because my Spanish was so bad. I don't want to use it. it was because I've lost a lot of my stance because I don't use it on a daily basis anymore. And I'm really bummed about that. But I really do believe that, you know, once I go back to a Spanish-speaking country or a setting where Spanish is necessary, I'll pick it back up. You never lose it. It's kind of like riding a bike, I think. Thank you, Sonia, for emailing. You can email back anytime. Just got an email from Mike. Mike, thank you for emailing. Mike writes, I get the students to participate by asking open-ended questions. Who, when, where, you know, our inverted pyramid, Mike, absolutely. Who, when, where, why, and how. Fantastic. Open-ended questions. It kind of always annoyed me. Yeah, but that's definitely a good point, Mike, because when I was in school, I used to always be quiet in those classes where the teacher, the professor, was looking for an answer. Well, there is no an answer. There's lots of different answers. That's why I like open-ended questions. I've always said, if you ask, well, I used to be a journalist, and we were taught in journalism school, if you ask a yes or no question, expect a yes or no answer. Those open-ended questions that Mike's talking about permit students to really open up a lot more. And yeah, sure, people give you irrelevant information all the time. You ever listen to me, I give you irrelevant. Every other sentence out of my mouth is irrelevant. But I talk a lot more by responding to open-ended questions. Mike, that was perfect. Thank you. You email back anytime. Man, look at this, folks. We got everybody emailing. I just got an email from V. Thank you, V, for emailing. V writes, when administering reading fluencies, is it ever a good idea to pair students with limited reading proficiency together for the read instead of a teacher assistant reading? I'm not sure I quite understand the question there. She continues, the problem I see with this is, as the only fluency assessment is that students may not know the word themselves or may simply not be listening and paying attention. This does not give a good interpretation of fluency levels, in my opinion. Am I off base here? I see where you're getting at. Thank you for emailing that. One of the difficulties I have with a lot of fluency assessments that I see is, for one, anybody who knows, I have a problem with any kind of standardized assessment, which is a one-shot assessment. I think it is grossly unfair to base an opinion on a kid based on one small exam. And the problem that I've seen with a lot of fluency assessments is, a reading fluency assessment will judge a student, mark them down if they skip a word or replace a word. I'll tell you what the problem is there. Those are both characteristics of good readers as well as bad readers. I mean, I can tell you, I skip over words like the and of all the time while I'm reading. I had a kid reading aloud to me once, and he said, Little Home on the Prairie. Well, based on the way I'm supposed to assess him, I'm supposed to mark him down for saying home instead of house. And did he change the meaning there at all? Not at all. I mean, a lot of readers would have read it. A good reader reads it really quickly like that. But based on the way I'm supposed to judge to assess that exam, he was judged down. Now, I see a lot of these oral proficiency exams where we're looking at the fluency of the person. You know what? All of us can tell when a person is comfortable speaking a language. I mean, when I used to teach over at USC, English is a second language, I got to assess orally every single student coming into the university that was an international student. And it's fascinating listening to people from different countries and the way they phrase things. And then try to figure out what fluency means. I mean, because a person can be fluent and still sound a little bit awkward in the way they phrase things. I mean, fluency doesn't mean you're native-like all the time. So I have students, and I come
to America for study of engineering,
and it doesn't sound like an American, but they're completely fluent. I mean, they understand everything. I mean, I understand everything that they're saying, and it's not completely awkward. They're just I would never say, I come for study, I come to study. It's how a native-like person would say it. But, I mean, really, does that mean this person is going to have difficulties expressing themselves in English? Not at all. So I hope that kind of answers that. In terms of, you're talking about putting the kids together, I think you always kind of get what you expect. You know, if you put all the low kids together and they're always around low models, they're always going to be around that. I think we've talked in here about Vygotsky's zone of functional development, and basically what that means is what my mom used to say when I was a kid. Stop hanging out with those idiots! You tend to act like the people you hang out around. this is why I think you have difficulty, for example, in a lot of schools here in Los Angeles. Let's say we're in an elementary school in East Los Angeles, if 99% of the students at that school speak Spanish as a primary language, those kids are at a disadvantage for learning English compared to a kid that is part of only 20% of the students speaking Spanish, because that kid is going to be forced to use English in much more authentic ways, whereas the Spanish-speaking kid is surrounded by a lot of Spanish-speaking models, and they can kind of use the crutch of Spanish all the time. And again, don't get me wrong, I think Spanish is great and everything, but I think if what we're aiming for is proficiency in two languages, you're at a severe disadvantage when you're not having to use that language. Just like I'm at a severe disadvantage now in learning more Spanish because I'm not using it on a daily basis. I don't have any reason to use it. Now, if I had a reason to use it, I would do much better at it. All right? Hope that helps you, B. Thank you so much for your email. You can email back anytime. Just got an email from Vanessa. Folks, I love this class. You do such a great job.
Yeah, they do an assistant professor again. They keep on doing this to me. They put me down as assistant professor. I'm an associate professor, and I'm up for full professor right now. Darn it.
They took me down. Yeah, they heard me there. Yeah, associate. Vanessa just wrote, thank you, Vanessa, for writing. She writes, to be exposed to as many languages as possible, park yourself on a bench in Disneyland. That is absolutely, completely 100% correct, Vanessa. Actually, you can do that pretty much anywhere in Los Angeles, to be exposed to a ton of languages. Isn't it amazing how, Vanessa, you can go anywhere in Los Angeles and be exposed to so many different types of cultures? I took my wife and my mother-in-law up to Glendale yesterday to Americana. Which is just, it's so ironic to me that it's now the big thing is to create shopping malls here in Los Angeles that kind of look identical to hometowns in America around the square. It's just beautiful. Americana is just beautiful. Like I said, they're all doing that. I encourage you all to go there. We got this Christmas tree up and the trolley car. And I mean, it felt like I was in Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood or something. It's just beautiful. But the greatest thing about Los Angeles, what I always say, I could run the Chamber of Commerce. I mean, you can go around the world in 80 minutes in this town, and I think it's so great for all kids to be exposed to all those different languages and opportunities. So, Vanessa, thank you for your email. Everybody, I love the participation in this class. I never get to any of my notes because I'm so busy answering your emails and your questions, and I love it. Give us a call at 1-800-339-1193. I love hearing your pretty voices. Let's get into some more of my notes. You know, children's oral language develops naturally from exposure, all right? And again, this is what I was just saying. A kid that's going to be exposed in a setting where they're exposed to a lot more English, that kid's going to have a higher likelihood of picking up English than the kid that's not in that type of setting. It's further enriched when they listen to the language of literature and engage in activities such as memorizing poems. I'm going to talk about poetry today. I think poetry is the most underutilized resource in our classrooms today. I used to read aloud 4 poems a day to my students. Now think about that. Over the course of 180 school days, I exposed my students to over 700 poems. Now, isn't it amazing how much better they're going to read because of that exposure? You know, 4 poems take maybe, 10 minutes of class time, folks. I expose my kids to a Shel Silverstein, to a William Shakespeare, to an Emily Dickinson, to a Gwendolyn Brooks, a Jack Bruce, lots of different, so many great poets out there. Poems are succinct. They're a lot less intimidating books than books because they're so much shorter, many poems. I get my kids memorizing poems. Like if you ever came to my classroom on a Thursday, Thursday was Poetry Thursday in my classroom, so every kid became a poem. So I was great with a differentiating instruction, too. So let's say I've got one of my lower students, Jose, who's a non-reader. Well, Jose, he's like, "Hi, I'm a Sitter by Shel Silverstein. Mrs. Newtwater, the babysitter, I think she's a little bit crazy. She thinks a babysitter's supposed to sit on the baby." And then I get Laura, one of my higher students, and she comes up to me. She's like, "Hi, I'm Mark Anthony from Julius Caesar by William Shakespeare. Friends, Romans, country, and one mere ears. I found a very sage not to praise him. The evil in men do lose after them, the good is often turned with their bones. So let it be with Caesar. He was my friend, loyal and just to me, but Brutus, his honorable man, this little girl, memorized 50 lines from Julius Caesar. How is that possible?" I always wondered, is it possible for a kid to learn that much? Then I saw kindergarten come with our governor, Arnold Schwarzenegger, and he got his kindergartners to memorize the Gettysburg Address one. I wonder if that's possible. I've done it with kids. It is. Kids are amazing. They can do whatever you tell them they can do. It's amazing working with children. I hope you're all excited about teaching my kids as much as I am. Just got another email from Eva. Thank you, Eva, for emailing. Eva, she's always emailing. I always appreciate that. She writes, we can encourage students to use English in the classroom by having a positive, welcoming environment and asking questions where the students can give their personal opinions and experiences. Absolutely. I found kids love to talk about things they did. That is awesome. Thank you so much, Eva. I'm so glad you're teaching. Promote those positive learning environments. So I've said it now three times. I was in Asheville, North Carolina the other day. In Asheville, I was talking to all 33 different schools there and their literacy teams. And I could feel a real negative energy in the room. And, you know, they've been forced to use all these scripted reading programs and, you know, all these standards and the national education standards, you know, so they can get all these federal dollars to show the achievement. And I just thought there's so much pressure and duress, and I just feel the negative energy. And anything about me, you know, keep it positive, folks. I don't believe human beings work at their best when they're under a lot of stress. I think you need to stop taking yourself too seriously and remember why you're here. You're here to make kids feel happy. Happy kids produce happy parents. Happy parents come from California, I think. A little bit of positivity can go a long way. So, Eva, you write back anytime. I know you will. Thank you so much for that email. An effective program in language development builds on the language children bring to school. So, again, that's why we need to keep it in mind, our demographics of our schools, how we're are shaping our schools. I've always told people, you know, be careful what you reward. It kind of annoys me that I see so much money go to failing schools. You know, if I was in charge, and I don't want to be in charge, but if I were in charge, I would stop giving money to failing schools. I let them fail. Get rid of them. Get rid of them. Give the money to the succeeding schools. Why give money to somebody that's failing? Because you give them money, it ain't going to help them. They're going to just want more money. Get the successful schools. Keep on building up the successful schools. There are so many successful schools just here in Los Angeles. A lot of people don't know about them because you never hear about them. But there's plenty of them replicated, and they're not just all charter schools. The charter schools are fantastic, but there's plenty of public schools that are fantastic as well. You give me a good principal and a good team, you can move them out, but you can get those parents involved, get those kids focused on positivity. You know, if you focus on learning and not test scores, it's amazing how those test scores actually go up. Kind of crazy, some of the things we see in education nowadays. All right, let's keep going. And dealing off a soapbox. So, all children need to learn the language of education. All right, now this is something we've talked about all semester long. There's a difference between what we call basic, Jimmy Cummins called it this, basic interpersonal communication skills, BICS, which in English we said means playground talk. There's a difference between that and academic language. Cummins calls cognitive academic language proficiency, CALP, or school talk. School talk is something that has to be mastered. Lisa Delpit wrote this great book called Other People's Children, and she emphasized that she wasn't just specifically talking about ESL students. She was talking about there's plenty of students in America that speak non-standard English dialects, whether it's Ebonics or Spanglish or Appalachian. You know, there's lots of different dialects here in America, and kids need to learn the standard as well. The standard, the academic language. The way I used to always say to kids is, you know, with my boys, I'd say, hey, watch ESPN, watch the way the coaches talk, and watch the way the athletes talk. In school, I want us talking like the coaches. Now, I never degrade the way people talk, because all of us talk differently with our buddies than we do with our coworkers and our teachers. But we need to understand that there's the time to use different types of language. Now, this is interesting because a great colleague of mine, Lilia Sarmean, so if you've ever taken a class with Lilia, she's wonderful. Lilia was just showing me that the RECA scores, which is the reading test that teachers get in the credentials test to take, the RECA scores have gone down significantly since they changed the test to the new RECA exam. So it used to be about an 82% passage rate, and it just went down to around a 68%. was an academic language. So it's interesting to me because vocabulary is a big deal to me. This is one of the things I like to emphasize with all of my students and my teachers here.
Okay.
We need to encourage our students whose first language is not English to use English consistently when they're in their English language arts classes and in try to promote as many authentic different experiences as possible for our students because what we want to try to aim at is to get kids to stop trying to translate in their head and just provide authentic experiences where the kid has to spontaneously use English in the situation. That's what a good teacher's always striving for. English language, you need to realize, this is important folks, the English language has by far the largest vocabulary of any language. I think number two, I believe, is German. It's either German or French. German and French each have between 100,000 and 150,000 working vocabulary words. Here in English, we have over 500,000 in our working vocabulary. The reason English is great is the same reason American is great. It's stronger for its diversity. It accepts everything and everybody, which makes it stronger for its diversity, but it makes it a mess when it's trying to, when we're trying to figure out the rules. I mean, this is so, one of the reasons we need to embrace immigration in our country, not freak out about it. Thank goodness for immigrants. All these different languages have helped contribute to the English language. Like, for example, thank goodness for our immigrants from India. The Hindi language gave us the term shampoo. Without Hindi, we'd all be going around with a lot of dirty hair here in America. All right? You know, that's from Hindi. Thank goodness for Arabic. The word alcohol comes to us from Arabic. Thank goodness for Arabic, folks. Slavic languages like Russian and Polish gave us important terms like robot, stroganoff, and vodka. Thank goodness for all those Slavic languages. Now, when Jack Norse and his friends invaded England back in the 9th century, the Norse, those Vikings, they introduced all kinds of different terms. Some of the terms they introduced are anger, cake, husband, and ugly. And I've always been curious if that was the order in which they introduced those terms. Can you imagine? I'm very angry. You have husband, cake. Oh, me want husband. He ugly. All right, so that is the contribution of Chuck Norris and his friends. Well, then, the bosses, William the Conqueror and friends, came over in 1066 to conquer England. And not only did they dominate England politically for a couple of hundred years, but they also dominated the English language quite a bit for the next 200 years. So thank goodness for the French. I mean, the French, there's a lot of French influence in our language. I mean, but because of the French, if it weren't for the French, we wouldn't have to pay taxes in this country because the word tax comes to us courtesy of the French language. We'd all be a bunch of atheists in America because the word religion comes to us courtesy of the French language. You wouldn't be able to watch Law and Order if it wasn't for the French because just about every single courtroom term is a French term and we have nothing to read because words like poetry, history, and story, these are all courtesy of the French folks. Now, dances with words also had a huge impact on the English language. When the people from Europe came to the Americas, New Zealand, and Australia, they had things here in these places that they didn't have in Europe. So the Europeans just accepted the terminology that was used. So, for example, they didn't have coyotes or kangaroos in England. So they just kept the word coyote and kangaroo. A lot of people don't realize over half the states in America are Native American expressions, terms like Florida, Illinois, Alabama. These are all Native American expressions. All right, so we should be embracing all of these different nations and people that have helped make America what it is today and makes English what it is today. Although there are many variations in English's oral form, students need to recognize that its written form has been relatively stable for centuries. All right, we'll talk more about this next couple of weeks when we're talking about reading and writing. Now, practically any adult who is trying to learn a second language can attest to how frustrating an experience it can be. Can you imagine what that is? Oh, and I just got an email. This is from the studio. This is good. something to, this is a good one, to, a good question to ask all of you. This is for you, the viewers. Do you have a favorite foreign word that became part of the English language? If you have a favorite foreign word that has become part of the English language, feel free to give us a call at 1-800-339-1193 or send us an email at dhtv.csudh.edu. We'd love to hear foreign words that become part of the English language that you love. There's all kinds of them. Of great words that I love, but I'm not going to tell you unless you tell me yours. You need to know, it's pretty frustrating learning a second language as an adult, but what a lot of you don't realize, it's just as frustrating for kids. Now, we've talked about this all semester, the common misconception is that kids learn language easier than adults. Now, we've proven that adults learn language easier, but kids acquire language easier. Kids pick things up. It's a lot less demanding the language responsibilities of a child. I mean, again, I always use the example, you talk to a baby, they say, da-da, say, da-da, say, da-da. Baby says, da-da.
Yay, da-da!
All right, if you're a middle-aged man, you're like, da-da, yay! Special bus for you right over there. All right, a lot less demanding than talking about, like, economic policy or something like that. I mean, that's one of those misconceptions. Now, again, ESL teachers must realize that quick-and-easy solutions are not appropriate for complex problems. Second language learning by school-age children takes longer and is harder and involves more effort than many teachers realize. It ain't easy picking up a second language. And to demonstrate this point, I have a fun film clip. I always like to give you some fun clips. And so this first clip today is from the recent version of the movie The Pink Panther with Steve Martin. And this is actually one of the very few funny scenes from the movie, but this is a funny scene from the movie when Inspector Clouseau is trying to learn English from a master, a dialect coach. So enjoy this very, it's about a 2-minute clip from the film, The Pink Panther, starring the wonderful Steve Martin.
I would like to buy a hamburger.
I would like to buy a hamburger.
I would like to buy a hamburger.
I would like to buy an hamburger.
No, let's break it down.
Steve Martin's the co-host of the Academy Awards this coming year. I'm very happy about that. Give us a call at 1-800-339-1193 or send us an email at dhtv.csudh.edu. We're talking all about listening and speaking in a second language today, and I hope you're enjoying things so far. I am. So we're continuing about talking about listening processes. So we need to know that listening can be divided by purpose. You need to understand, is the purpose of the lesson, is it a conversational one, so is it a what we call a fixed lesson, or is it more of an academic purpose, which would be a CALP lesson. We just talked about fixed and CALP, and then think about your comments, is it a context embedded situation, that would be is the more context, the better for anybody trying to learn anything. Again, we've talked about it all semester. What's good for ESL students is good for all students. Or is it a context-reduced situation? Context-reduced would be a situation, you know, like that teacher with Steve Martin. She didn't really give him any context. She was just saying, can you predict if I had like a more context-embedded situation is to go to McDonald's, which I recently found out. A lot of the French might have a problem with Americans and hamburgers, but I didn't realize America has the most McDonald's in the world. The number two country is France. France has the second most number of McDonald's in the world. They just started, they're building McDonald's at the Louvre now. Isn't that amazing? It's got a really enormous French. All right. Let's get into different types of listening. So we can talk about listening for beginning comprehension. During ESL students' initial silent period, they may still demonstrate comprehension through active participation. They do this through nonverbal participation. There's plenty of gestures and things like that that the students could be using. When teachers ask questions, students can demonstrate understanding by pointing at pictures, gesturing, nodding. I mean, even Land of the Lost, that's what they can do in Chaka. Pointing, things like that. You can do that with the kids. And I talked about this earlier. A lot of teachers, what they'll do is they'll set up listening centers, listening stations where kids can audio tape themselves or listen to audio tapes, or they can have peer interaction when they're talking with their peers in primary or secondary language. Okay, then there's a thing called listening to repeat. This is another type of purpose we can have, listening to repeat. Now, listening to repeat, here's something I wanted to do for you. I love to show my students how their brains work, and this is an activity. This activity requires you at home to get a piece of paper and a pen, because I'm going to show you a picture of a bed behind me. But get a piece of paper and a pen right now, and I'm going to show you this picture of a bed behind me, and I'm going to give you a listening activity. Thank you, Esmeralda. Esmeralda got a picture of the bed today. Okay, so here's what we're going to do. You need your pen and paper. This will be fun, I'm telling you right now. Okay. Now, here's what you do. I'm going to read aloud a list of words. Now, I don't want you to write down the list as I say them. I just want you to concentrate on the list of words, all right? And then after I complete my list of words, I'm going to ask you to write down as many words as you can remember, okay? This is just to show you how your brain works. It's going to be a lot more fun for you if you actually do the activity. All right, you ready? Read aloud this list of words. Now tap your head if you understand me. Okay. Read aloud the list of words and listen to them first, and then we'll write them down. All right, here's the list. Pillow, sheet, night, wake, doze, dream, night, relax, artichoke, night, spread, drift, comfort, sleep. Okay, write down as many words as you can remember that I just said. All right, you're writing them down right now. I'm taking a drink of water while you're writing down all those words. Keep on writing those words. Let's see how many of the words you actually were able to remember. A couple more seconds to write down all those words. It's a lot of them. It's a lot easier, you know, obviously when I have a live class, I can see how many of you are finishing writing down. I can't do that at home. But this is a fun activity if you're actually participating in it. And this is something, feel free to liberate this activity and share it with your students. It's a great way of showing how people's minds work. Okay, let's see what words you were able to get. Raise your hand at home if you wrote down the words pillow and sleep. All right. Generally, a lot of people get pillow and sleep. And what that's called the primacy and recency effect. Your brain tends to remember the first and last items in a list of information. Okay. Now raise your hand if you wrote down the word night. All right. A lot more of you probably wrote down the word night. That's called the repetition effect. Now, this is a very good effect because the brain tends to remember things that are repeated. I actually said the word night 3 times, and the brain tends to do a good job of remembering things that it's repeatedly exposed to. Now, raise your hand if you wrote down the word artichoke. Okay, I bet you almost all of you wrote down the word artichoke. And what that's called, it's called the surprise effect. Your brain constantly wants to classify information. And when it finds something that doesn't match the pattern, it immediately puts it in a different part of the brain. This is a very effective teaching strategy. It's a surprise effect. How can you surprise your students? So if you're usually a very dull teacher, how can you get a little goofy and surprise them? Or what is it that you can do to make every lesson a little bit surprising to get your ESL students to remember things? And yet, remember what's good for ESL students is good for all students, okay? And then finally, how many of you wrote down the word bid? Okay, probably a few of you. All right, what that's called is the false memory effect. I never said the word bid. But just the fact that I had a picture of a bed behind me and gave you a list of words related to a bed, you wrote down the word bed. All right, what kinds of false memories are we creating for a lot of our students? A lot of times we do this not intentionally, but it happens all the time. So I hope you enjoyed that. That's just something when we're talking about listening to repeat something. I like to point out to people repetition is really a good idea. Surprise is a very good idea. Hopefully that was fun for you. If not, then it's over, so don't worry about it. Just got an email from Suzanne. Thank you, Suzanne, for emailing. She writes, what do you suggest we do for students we get in middle or high school that have very little or no English in our history or science classes? And then, you know, Susan, thank you so much for writing that, Suzanne, because this is the biggest problem, you know. I wouldn't say problem, it's the biggest challenge. I mean, it's tough enough to get a student in kindergarten that has limited or no English proficiency. But what if they come to us in middle school or high school? You know, this is when we're going to have to really create a lot of context for the students. It's even more difficult for you as a history or a science teacher or a math teacher, because obviously your job isn't to teach English. But this is what I always tell people is whether or not you think you're an English teacher or you think you're a reading teacher, you are all the time an English and a reading teacher. The best thing, you know, you've got to create tons of content. You've got to get the kids to be part of that experience. I've shown videos the past couple of weeks of specifically middle school teachers and the types of things that they're doing with their students. You know, they're engaging their students. A couple of the videos I showed showed that teachers that were able to speak primary language to the students, they allow students to respond in primary language. That's a good thing no matter what. To be able to communicate in any way in the primary language to the students at least shows the students that you care enough about them and you're trying to communicate with them. It takes time. We know it only takes a couple of years to pick up the basics of the language, but it takes an additional at least 5 to 7 years to really start to master the academic language. So I always really urge patience on the side of most teachers and schools is, you know, again, one of the things I've learned is just because you're the best kid in kindergarten doesn't mean you're not going to be selling drugs once you make it to high school. Just because you were the kid in the back sniffing glue in kindergarten doesn't make you a valedictorian someday. You know, we need a lot more patience. You know, on the application of Harvard, it doesn't ask you when you learned how to read. It just knows that you know how to read. If I get a kid in 7th grade and they don't speak a word of English, it is kind of crazy for me to think that by the end of the year, they're going to know English. But it's not unreasonable for me not to think that I can help really improve this kid significantly this year. I like to look at myself as a coach. A lot of coaches, they get freshmen that aren't ready to start yet. And my job is over the next 4 years to get this kid so that they're an All-American on the varsity team. So it's basically a lot of patience and a lot of context, and don't take yourself too seriously. Put yourself in the shoes of your kids, Suzanne, because it ain't easy trying to learn something that you have no background in whatsoever. So our job is to provide as much background, as much positive energy as possible. I hope that was sufficient for Suzanne. If not, send me another email, because I empathize, because that's a challenge a lot of us are having. I think teachers are too tough on themselves. You know, I think we're very overly critical. I see teachers that are like, my lesson plan totally gone today. I'm like, wow, how many times have you done that lesson plan? I'm like, well, this is the first time I've done it. I'm like, wow, that's amazing. Because you know what? I learned how to walk in one day. You know what I'm saying, folks? It takes a lot of trial and error to get good at anything. You know, I'm still striving to be a much better professor. I'd be talking all the time. Shows that I'm not a very good professor. I need you all calling. We haven't gotten a single call yet today. 1-800-339-1193. But you've been sending tons of emails. I love the emails. I'm just sick of listening to my own voice. Okay, we're talking about listening to repeat. at the early intermediate stage of second language acquisition, again, I've given names to different stages. Don't worry about names. You have different stages of kids that you're recognizing. You know, we've talked about the five in here before. Let me see what our formal names of them are. Here's what we've identified as our five stages of English language development. Here we said beginning stage, early intermediate, intermediate, early advanced, and advanced. You can call these things whatever you want, folks. Don't get hung up on educational jargon. You know, a lot of you in your language autobiographies, you called it your like non-talking stage, your grunting stage. I mean, call them whatever you want. I mean, whatever helps you out. Don't get caught up in the educational jargon. I'm a big believer in teachers using poems, nursery rhymes, or songs to introduce rhyming words, and students can fill in the blanks. Now, I'll even do this. This was, I was talking about middle school and high school students. I even use a lot of this with my middle school and high school students. Contrary to popular belief, 12th graders love listening to Dr. Seuss or anybody, especially if they're an ESL student, and you're providing them an opportunity to do a positive learning experience. One of the things I'll do is I'll get 12th graders to create their own kids' books and read them to third grade classes, and they have a lot of fun doing that. So that's just one of the things. And then I'm a big believer of using songs and chants. Everybody knows I love songs and chants. Why do I love songs and chants? I was in choir when I was a kid, you know, and I go, Amazing Grace. It didn't matter that I didn't know the rest of the song. 30 other kids had my back. And after about 3 weeks, I figured out the rest of the lyrics, but it was cool. The teacher never put me on the spot. I had a lot of kids in September that don't speak a single word of English, but we do our songs and chants every day. And by December, they're giving out and away, at least about those common routines that we're doing. I mean, we do. All right, here's one for the little ones. We go left hand, right hand, give a little clap. Left hand, right hand, put them on your lap. Pretty easy, folks. Come up with plenty of songs and chants and things like that. I used to do that with my kids all the time. For lunch, we go. Another one goes for lunch. I tap on my head and go, and another one gone, and another one gone. Another one goes for lunch. I'm gonna get you too. Another one goes for lunch. Folks, that aren't long. You're gonna leave my pride at the door every single day. If you get your kids learning, that's all that matters. You know, don't take yourself so seriously. You should bring the fun back in your classroom all the time. Man, I'm way behind, all right? I was telling them before, take every phone call. I don't know if I have enough material. I have 15 pages. I'm on page 4 right now. It's unbelievable. I talk too much. All right. Well, that's good. We're talking about speaking and listening today. Let's talk about listening to understand through task. We want our students to perform tasks at this stage, such as writing a correct response to selecting a correct answer to a verbal question. Typical classroom tasks include listening to an audio tape and completing a true-false exercise based on the content, listening to a pre-recorded speech and circling vocabulary items on a list, and listening to a lecture and completing an outline of the notes. Students may be asked to listen for more specific purposes to enhance our listening for understanding. ESL students listen to stories and information, responding appropriately using both verbal and nonverbal responses. They listen for main ideas, details, and sequences. They listen for implied meaning, and they apply knowledge, vocabulary, idiomatic expressions, yada, yada, yada. Okay. Sick of me. All right. I'm going to show you a clip. This is from one of the greatest children's authors of all time, a guy by the name of Dr. Seuss, or as my little ones used to call him, Dr. Seuss. This is a clip from Dr. Seuss's wonderful book, The Cat in the Hat, and this is where the Cat in the Hat teaches a couple of kids how to say cat and cat in different languages. It's good for your listening skills. That's about a 5-minute clip. Enjoy this clip from The Cat in the Hat by Dr. Seuss.
And you are not a cat. Whoever heard of a 6-foot cat? Well, I have a cat. You're not a cat in a hat. Everything's not a hat. You're not a cat. I am indeed a cat. And this, indeed, is a hat.
In English, cat. Hat. In French, chapeau.
It really is quite obvious, don't you know?
English cat, hat, in French, chapeau.
The words I had to say, here we go.
Talked about how you loved the show I had when I had my friend.
he's really a great expert at listening to and how to really hear people, not just listen. You really need to learn this as a skill. Too many people don't listen. And again, I really think that our leaders in Washington, D.C., they can really use a listening course, because I honestly don't think they're as far apart as they think. They're just so into what their own speeches say that they're not listening to the other side. I think that they really could come up with some solutions. Listeners constantly draw upon their background knowledge and prior experiences in order to comprehend what they hear. This is something we've been talking about all semester. And we can organize our instruction before, during, and after instruction. So some before listening ideas for us. When we're trying to think about listening, it depends on a variety of aspects, such as the aim, the text type, or the level of our students. It's useful to encourage students to think about and discuss what they're going to hear. I mean, preview is so effective with students. You got to build up on that background knowledge. It's just like I was telling Suzanne earlier, you know, it's all about context. Provide as much context as possible. It really helps in assisting all of your students, and not just your ESL students. Give them the big picture. You know, it's teaching is like a jigsaw puzzle. It helps when you see the whole picture first. Maybe you ever seen the movie The Karate Kid. Maybe I should have shot a clip from The Karate Kid, but I'm not. Anyway, there's a scene in The Karate Kid where Mr. Miyagi says, you know, Danielson's like, what are you saying, man? Do a horse. You know, and Mr. Miyagi's like, call me, I saw. And Danielson's like, what's up, Lexa? And Mr. Miyagi's like, no, Lexa, And Danielson's like, oh, I was learning karate. Dude, Mr. Miyagi, if you're a good teacher, before you have the kid do all your housework, just say that the repetitive motions you're going to be practicing doing all my chores are the same motions you need to successfully master the skill of karate, you know? But how often do teachers do that? So many teachers teach kids some skill. It's not just ESL students. All kids can do this. The teacher teaches them some skill without telling kids why they're learning this. I swear to God, half of kindergartners in America have no clue why they're there. They're like, what's going on, man? Mom kind of just dropped me off here one day. You know, let kids in on the secret. Before listening, also another very useful thing to do are to use lucid fingers props. You know, the best teachers I've ever seen was a guy named Fred Rogers, Mr. Rogers. Mr. Rogers came on his show. He'd be like, hi, boys and girls. This is a watch. You ever wonder how watches are made? And I'm at home going, all he used was some little cheap prop. Alfred Hitchcock, the master of suspense. That's what he used to do in all these movies. He got you so focused on what we call a MacGuffin that you didn't pay attention to other things around you. I mean, that's what a good teacher can do, is they can get their kids focused in on something. Using something before the exercise is a great way to focus in your kids. And free listening activities can include introducing key vocabulary and previewing the text structure as well. Very, very important. Okay, when we're talking about speaking and listening, I think one of the greatest films of all time, and I can't believe it didn't win Best Picture, unbelievable, it's called Singin' in the Rain with Gene Kelly. I'll tell you what, Singin' in the Rain was nominated for Best Picture back in 1952. All right, you know what won Best Picture in 1952? The Greatest Show on Earth. Yeah, exactly. Nobody's ever seen that movie. Although, I was amazed. One of my idols, Steven Spielberg, said The Greatest Show on Earth was one of his favorite movies, and I just don't see it. It's such a horrible... It's funny because it's made by the same people that made The Ten Commandments. So it's Cecil B. DeMille. And what is great, it's got like Charles Heston, you know, running the circus. And it has the same narrator as The Ten Commandments. So you're used to... You guys just watch this one night. Watch this and The Ten Commandments. Because The Ten Commandments, you know, you have that narrator, and he's like, you know... And the Jews left Egypt to find the promised land, and Moses led them. Well, The Greatest Show on Earth is the exact same narrator, but he's talking about a circus. So it's like, and the men raise the big top. You know, it's so annoying. All right, so that one Best Picture. You know, two other movies that were nominated that year: Singin' in the Rain and High Noon. Are you kidding me? Unbelievable. All right. Why did I just talk about that? Well, I'm a movie buff. Everybody knows me, knows I'm a movie buff. I love Singing in the Rain. It should have won Best Picture. Here is a great scene from Singing in the Rain when, at this stage, talking movie. If you have not seen Singing in the Rain, you got to go do that right now. Singing in the Rain. The movie, just to give you background, the movie is about the silent films of the 1920s, and a big movie star finds out all of a sudden that the jazz singer comes out and talkies become popular, and so all the movie studios are scrambling to produce talkies, but these two movie stars that were big in silent films, now they have to talk, and one of the stars, the female, Lena Lamont, one of the greatest characters of all time, Lena Lamont, is learning how to speak with her diction coach. Let's just say that Lena Lamont's voice isn't exactly appropriate for the new popular talkie. So enjoy this clip from Singing in the Rain. This is Lena Lamont with her diction coach.
Now, ta te ti to to. No, no, Miss Lamont, round tones, round tones. Now let me read your line.
And I can't stand.
And I can't stand him.
And I can't stand.
Can't.
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 That's Lena Lamont. I absolutely love that from Singing in the Rain. So some strategies ESL students and teachers can use to prepare for a listening experience. Activate existing knowledge. Get into that background knowledge. Build on the prior knowledge students have. Review your standards for listening. Give them some tips and strategies. This is always very important. Establish a purpose for what you're going to be listening to. And use a listening guide. You know, often I'll give kids outlines and things like that to help them out as well. So for this class, what I've given all of you, you've all gotten your e-textbook. And so those of you that purchase the e-textbook, you find the class much more easy to grasp because you can go right along. I follow the notes of the e-textbook. Okay, let's go into some during listening ideas. Now, while students rarely have difficulties understanding what they hear in their first language, ESL students often grapple with unfamiliar sounds, words, and structures, and speed of English. I mean, you know, it's kind of like when I know Spanish, you know, you go to different Spanish-speaking countries, you get totally different experiences. Even within Mexico, it depends on what portion of Mexico you're in. You know, the metropolitan areas, they speak much faster, you know, and then you go into, like, rural areas, and it's a, hola, ¿cómo estás? You know, very laid back. Can you imagine, like, it's also kind of difficult. You come to Los Angeles, imagine you're a Spanish-speaker in Los Angeles, how difficult it is trying to figure anything out in Los Angeles. We have Spanglish everywhere, like, I knew a little bit of Spanish when I got to Los Angeles, so I kept on saying, I'm going to go to Los Feliz today, I'm going to take La Cienega Boulevard, you know, well, you know, we call it La Cienega and Los Feliz, you know, even Los Angeles, it's not nice, you know, so we have all this kind of Spanglish going on, it's confusing to everybody here in Los Angeles. Additionally, if your ESL students are not familiar with the topic being discussed, they're going to have some major difficulties when asked to listen to new information and answer some questions. As students at a double disadvantage, they don't understand the language and they don't understand the content. This will be more difficult. They keep on getting back to Suzanne's email. It's really difficult when teaching at the middle school and high school level because it's much more demanding cognitively on some of the academic concepts we're trying to get across to our students. The ESL teachers can provide students with outlines as they listen to questions. Again, I'm a big believer in outlines, things like that. And students can listen several times for different purposes. You know, one of the things I actually really like about this televised class, as opposed to being able to teach you live and in person, is a lot of you watch these shows over and over again. You bring your family, you sell tickets to admission because you're so enamored with me on every single week. Now, honestly, there are some people, and especially I have a lot of special needs students take this class, so that's why we provide closed captioning, and there's people that they'll watch it several times to try and grasp some of the concepts. I think that's wonderful, and it's a great teaching style. It's not just good teaching for special needs students. I've always hated the term special needs student because every student has special needs. I totally benefit from watching things again and again and again. I mean, that's how I learn information. After for listening. Some ideas for you. Many kinds of activities can follow a listening exercise. Students write, draw, read, discuss, or act out their interpretation of the content. Teachers can provide students with practice of idiomatic expressions, word meanings, comparing and contrasting, things like that. What's crucial for classroom teachers to consider is how most natural conversation takes place after listeners have shared a talk, a movie, etc. Thus, after listening activities focus on ESL students' comprehension of what they hear, they have heard. In your book, I provide some activities for listening comprehension by their ELD level. We identified those as beginning, early, intermediate, intermediate, early, advanced, and advanced. Again, you know, folks, you can call these things whatever you want. Those are some formal names of those stages, but all of us have recognized different stages, and those of you that do your language autobiographies identify your own language stages. All right, I'm going to show you another clip. I'm sitting on the right hand to show you another clip. This is the scene with Gene Kelly and Donald Connor. Their speech coach, and they're practicing diction. This is called Moses and Moses, and a good little song and dance number. Man, if you've not seen Singing in the Rain, folks, this is just, you know, Singing in the Rain. This is what Singing in the Rain does, you know. That's what Singing in the Rain does, too. It's like watching The Sound of Music. I mean, you can be in the worst mood in the world. How do you not smile watching The Sound of Music, you know, when the two nuns show that they've taken apart the Nazis' motors? I mean, does it get any better than that? Oh, you're getting me off track already. Okay, so this is another scene from Singing in the Rain. Enjoy, it's about a 3-minute clip.
Moses and Roses. But Moses supposes he wrote his name. Moses, he knows his toes aren't roses, as Moses supposes his toes to be. Moses supposes his toes aren't roses, but Moses supposes that wrote his name.
But Moses, he knows his toes aren't roses, and Moses supposes his toes to be.
show that clip. Maybe it's just because I want to show you Singing in the Rain. If you've never seen Singing in the Rain, go see Singing in the Rain. That had a little bit to do with language, a lot to do with dancing, but I love Singing in the Rain. Anyway, folks, I'm sick of hearing myself talk. Let's move on to that clip. We're going to take a commercial break, about a 10-minute break. When we come back, we focus mostly on speaking this first 70 minutes together. I'm going to try and cram in the last 40 minutes all about speaking. And so why don't you go grab a cup of coffee, go to the restroom, and I'll see you back here in 10 minutes. We'll talk all about speaking in a second line.
You are watching VHDB, television program service of California State University, New Vegas Hills.
Hello, I'm Dr. Melvin Garcia, president of Cal State University, New Vegas Hills. This year we begin to celebrate our 50th anniversary. Part of our history and an important point of pride for us is the worldwide recognition that our distance learning program has earned. For 20 years, our Center for Mediated Instruction and Distance Learning has made it possible for thousands of lifelong learners to pursue their educational goals, often without having to travel to our campus. For the third straight year, Dominguez Hills is proud to join the United States Distance Learning Association in recognizing National Distance Learning Week from November 9th through 13th. This event will celebrate innovations in teaching and identify unique learning opportunities. Best of all, you can be part of the dialogue about the future of education. To find out more about National Distance Learning Week, go to our distance learning website at dominguezonline.csudh.edu. We look forward to hearing from you.
I came here from Central California. My major is audio recording, and what brought me here to Dominguez Hills is their digital media arts program. I heard that many students that graduated from the program have gone on to receive awards and recognition. And I'm very happy with the staff and the program in general, and I'm glad to be a part of it.
SASH Dominguez is a multicultural theater company here at Cal State Dominguez Hills, and the program is designed to do play readings, workshops, and folk tale tours to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is that we are not doing theater so much as entertainment. Doing theater to help make our lives better is community service first and theater second. So, for instance, in Castro, we'll do a play reading of a play about assimilating its American culture and heritage in Britain. And that may be performed at middle school or year old kids. A number of teachers asked students to come into their classrooms to read scenes. We had workshops where we would bring like culture leadership or facilitator company to help our students learn about community based heritage. And the touring show is always interesting every year. We take folk tale, what we create a folk tale of our own, which is animals, folk events, and we tour and float some of the great classrooms. So, what Castro does is really educational theater. It is theater that focuses on social issues and has more of a direct purpose for society.
I took one of the distance learning classes. It's been more convenient, so it was nice to be at home in the mornings and watch it at home. Or if it didn't work out that way, David could watch it at my own leisure.
I took the distance learning course because it's I'm able to watch videos anytime I want at my convenience, and it's easy to do that. I can watch at home or either at the media center. And I would recommend this to a friend.
I came from Instrumento in San Diego, and my major is Digital Media Arts and TV. I chose CSU Dominguez Hills because I heard it had a very good TV program, and I like it because the teachers are very hands-on, they seem very nice, and it seems like a very good place.
Attention businesses in the South Bay of Los Angeles, the South Bay Resource Network, and the South Bay Bus Stops are here to help you grow.
I found out about the One Stop representative in my store and presented the services that they provide.
Excellent. We've opened over 4,000 applicants. I've only had 125 jobs, and One Stop really helped us find the gems and out of all those people.
On the business side, the One Stop provides not only training, but it provides the resources for the contacts. It also provides a resource for training between families. There's no paradigm for training reasons, so we offer classes and areas
today. It was just a great experience. In terms of the One Stop, we'll always have more understanding.
The services designed to open business to see the South Bay Resource Network is here for you. Call 310-970-7799 or visit our website at southbayresources.net.
The One Stop is your resource for business in the South Bay.
This is Myers.
Safety is our first concern. There's a lot that can go wrong. But Unfortunately, we have Cal State Dominguez Hills, the only authorized OSHA training center in the Los Angeles area. If you're in need of OSHA certification, or if safety is one of your concerns, call 888-4LA-OSHA and learn how to be safe. Remember, safety comes first.
Welcome back, everybody, to TED 407 Line. We're starting out your host, Dr. Danny Brissell, the proud associate professor of the College of Education here at California State University at Dominguez Hills. Today, we are talking all about speaking and listening and how to help our ESL students speak and listen a lot more in class. We focused on listening in our first 70 minutes together. Now, we're going to focus the rest on speaking. I always like to start off with a read aloud because I think reading aloud is the most important thing you should be doing with your students. And we're going to talk a lot more about that next week, but we'll start with the read aloud. This is from my unpublished book, From Backpacking to Marriage in 11 Complicated Steps. This is a chapter on observations of the Italian language. This is about my trip around the world with my future wife, who's now my wife. Jeannie manages to sleep on our trek from Brindisi to Bari while our train is forced to stop for one problem after another. The only problem I can figure out is that Italians probably designed the train. Jeannie and I sit across from a couple of older Italian gentlemen, Marco and Sergio. At least, I think that's what they told me. I can't really understand much of what they say. From the number of gestures they make with their arms, shoulders, and faces, I assume they are as perturbed as I am. Here's how I interpret their conversation.
What? The damn train stopped again? Mozzarella! Spaghetti! Michelangelo!
You couldn't be more right, my compatriot. Who is in charge here?
I'd like to strangle the imbecile.
Lasagna.
Why are these morons quite as scheduled if they're always running late? Fettuccine Alfredo.
And look at these two Americanos sitting across from us. They must think our country is inefficient. I hope they haven't been to Germany. Mamma mia.
The reason our country is shaped like a leg and foot is because the government needs a hip in the backside.
Indeed.
You have a problem with our government?
What are you, a fascist?
Bruschetta.
Fascist? I'm not a fascist, you admitted, son of a Greek.
Pasta primavera.
I'm sorry, my friend. That was low. Vigilati, Don Corleone.
You've got to admit, though, when Mussolini was in power, kids went to school. Trains were on time.
Exactamente. And with that, the two men laugh and smile at me. I'm somehow endeared to people who communicate by yelling and gesturing wildly at one another and then happily share a cappuccino afterward. I envy them like I do a child in a playground who cries one minute and giggles the next. Somebody published that book. I like writing books. All right, we're going to talk about speaking processes now. Although speaking is the hallmark of a second language learner, it is sometimes neglected in our classrooms. I mean, we need to really focus a lot more on speaking. It's easier to offer our ESL students drills than to facilitate authentic listening and speaking experiences. But I'll tell you right now, the more we facilitate as many authentic listening and speaking experiences as possible, the better our students are going to grow in their English capabilities. As a result of lots of drills, many ESL students are forced to practice speaking through preset dialogues, grammar presentations, do verb conjugations, ring a bell for any of you, and vocabulary lessons. This is the way we teach second languages in a lot of schools. Authentic communication requires students to spontaneously produce and understand language. So we're doing in our classrooms to help our students produce a lot more language in our classrooms. This is what I'm asking you to give me a call about. This is my first class. I never got a single phone call. But gets me emails, but no phone calls. Give us a call at 1-800-339-1193 to share your input. Or send us an email at dhtv.csudh.edu. Maybe you're not calling because you know we're nationwide today and you're a little bit nervous. Well, this is your chance to shine across the nation. Classroom activities such as role plays, problem solving tasks, and
interviews are a great way to facilitate a lot more speaking in your class. One of the things I used to do with my kids, I used to let them make folks on tape all the time and create lots of different tape conversations and let them listen to one another, to them all the time. I mean, God's Gift to Teachers, again, is 99 cents. Store or the Dollar Tree. Go get 10 of those cassettes for 99 cents. You can get a tape recorder that seems like for $6. Let the kids record lines of books on tape and conversations and listen to one another. And then you need to record along those as well. But I find letting the kids produce as much language as possible is fun for them and it engages them and they do it a lot more and it substantially improves their speaking ability. Now, research has shown that spontaneous conversations actually do a better job of helping ESL students master English, all right? Try promoting those spontaneous conversations as possible. Translation, don't focus on grammar all the time. It gets kids to hate language, and it doesn't help them as much as if you were producing some real, actual dialogue with students, some real discussions relating everything to students' background knowledge and prior experience. This is the way to teach any kid, not just an ESL kid. So, to constantly focus on this. Now, before speaking, what are some things we can do before speaking? Well, pre-speaking activities allow our students to become acquainted with topics and activate their prior knowledge similar to listening. It's the same as speaking. For example, if a teacher wanted to lead a discussion about a presidential election, students would be encouraged beforehand to read articles, watch television programs, and even pay attention to political billboards in order to practice key vocabulary and survey the content terrain before speaking. This is all, you know, in the end. Let's get back to that email I got from Suzanne. She was asking, what do I do with my kids that don't speak much English at the middle school level? Again, folks, we got to provide as much context and background as possible. Really get kids at ease. You know, I'm just a big believer of while a lot of people say, well, stress helps you about a lot of things, I'm like, in the short term, but I don't believe in the long term, stress is a very good way to teach content. I've always believed in sugar over vinegar, and I really believe in phone calls. I think I got my first phone call of the day. Let's see who we got. We got Harold Ball from Englewood. Thank you so much for calling, Harold. How are you?
Pretty good, Dr. Sir. How are you?
Fantastic. Thanks for calling. What can I do for you?
As far as developing second language learners' language, I've observed kids on the playground.
Uh-huh.
In third grade. And I listen to what they talk about, and I try to scaffold that particular subject when we go back in class.
So that's
talking about dinner or playing, something like that. And we try to use academic language when we go back into the classroom. And the second thing is that I was initially fooled when I listened to kids in the classroom. They seem like they have a good grasp of the language until I gave them a writing assignment.
Yeah.
Really show that their diction and counsel were not aligned. They had more of the basic communication skills, but the academic communication skills were still developing. But the conversation was great.
Yeah, do you have an A in your classroom, Harold?
I know, sir.
Yeah, because it's one of the things when you just said that, Harold, cracked me up because they would give me, you know, every now and then I get a Spanish speaking aid, and I found the same thing with my aides, that they could speak pretty well in English. But then once it got down to writing English in front of my students, I'm like, whoa, what's going on here? This was it was very deceptive, the difference in the speaking and listening skills versus the reading and writing skills. I love, Harold, that you're out on the playground listening to your kids. I think that's a great way of building on that background knowledge and then trying to facilitate that into Cal. Thank you so much for calling. You call back anytime. I love that. He had some really good ideas there, folks. I really love that Harold was out there on the playground with the kids. That was one of the best ways to get to know your kids and to really relate their background experiences to classroom experiences. All it usually takes is one phone call, the floodgates open, and then we'll get a whole bunch of other phone calls. Feel free to give us a call at 1-800-339-1193. I'd love for you all to share your ideas about how you're getting your kids to speak and listen in your classroom. Harold gave us some really good tips that I would encourage all of you to follow those. Now, let's see. One of the big things I'm into are role plays. I think role plays are a great way to get your kids talking. You can give them problem-solving tasks. You can have the kids interview one another. Again, do whatever it takes to produce as many different conversations with your students as possible. Again, I believe a loud classroom is a valuable classroom. The louder the kids are, the more they're talking, the more they are learning. So we want to do as much as we can to provide lots of speaking situations for our students. Now, again,
Before speaking, one of the things that I'll do with the kids is I'll give a lot of my students outlines. Like for this class, you have the e-textbook, so that gives you a pretty good heads up on what we're going to talk about every single week. If you're going to get your kids speaking in front of the class, you know, get them rehearsing and preparing as much as possible. My friend, co-author and mentor, Tim Rosinski, I think he's the world's expert on fluency. And he shows that really the best way to build students' reading fluency is through lots of repeated readings or Reader's Theater projects where the kids, they prepare Reader's Theater where they're going to make a presentation on Friday, but they practice it Monday through Thursday, and every repeated reading, they build their confidence in what they're reading. I did a similar approach I was telling you earlier about singing and chanting with my students by doing that repetition all the time. Repetition ain't a bad thing. We learned earlier on our brain exercise that our brain tends to remember things that it encounters on several occasions, so repetition can be very good. Now, while speaking, informal class discussions are a stress-reduced way to practice speaking. Formal presentations often intimidate your ESL students. Now, I'm always reminded of Jerry Seinfeld used to do this great routine where he said, Americans' number one fear is public speaking. Number two is death. So if you ever go to a funeral, people rather be in the coffin than deliver the eulogy. And I agree with him 100% on that. I see so many people that tense up in front of audiences. What's interesting is watching teachers, too, because a teacher can be completely comfortable with, you know, 7- and 8-year-olds, but you put them in front of their colleagues who are adults, and they tense up pretty tightly. So it's interesting how people can tense up. And I'm always trying to get my kids so they feel completely at home. So if you ever came to any of my classes, we made a presentation to the community at least once a month as a group, because there's strength in numbers and like just talking together. But we were always presenting in front of people because I want my kids to be a lot more relaxed in front of groups of people. It's a very powerful skill to have. Also, while speaking, it's important to note that correction while a person is speaking is seldom appropriate. I'll give you an example. This is just for those of you that just speak English. Think about it this way. You ever been to a party and you're sitting there and meet a new guy? You're like, oh yeah, oh you're from Los Feliz. I've been there often. And he's like, it's not often, it's often. Have you ever been around a person like that? What do you think of that person? Yeah, that person you'd love to meet around. Don't correct your kids. There's another way we can do it. It's called reformulation. Where I'll have, like my students, I've talked about this here before, I'm repeating myself. I'll have kids that'll ask me, Maestro, what time is lunch? And I'm like, what time is lunch? Lunch is at 11:15. I haven't corrected them. I just reformulated their question and modeled it back to them in an appropriate manner. All right? We'll do this fairly seamlessly. Don't make a big deal out of it. But kids pick up on it. Actually, most people pick up on that. And then after speaking, like with after listening, all kinds of different things, kids writing, drawing, reading, discussing, acting out their interpretations of newly presented content. Oral discussion, though, is always a top priority. When it's silence is deadly. You don't want a silent classroom. That's not doing any good to help kids facilitate their speaking and listening skills. So a loud classroom is exactly what we want to produce to promote more English development. More language development in general for our ESL students. Now, ESL teachers can organize their classrooms in ways they encourage the two most important elements of oral language development. They are comprehensible input and social interaction. We've talked about these in here before. Comprehensible input is we learn language in one way, one way only, when we understand the message. So how do we gesture, manipulative reality, building on the background knowledge, social interaction, working with others. These are very important for, again, all students, but especially our ESL students. The predictable routines are a great way to build this. Now, I've already told you, routines in my classroom, I used to always start off my day with lots of songs and chants. You know, it's all those predictable routines, like taking attendance and turning in homework and going to lunch and getting ready for recess and for going home. Those are some predictable routines, but, morning meeting is something I love. If it was up to me, the entire day would be morning meeting. I'll tell you why. To me, the first month of school, teachers should teach their students how to run their classroom, and the rest of the year, let the kids run it. You know,
know you go back to your desk, reach for paper, drink your shot, flip your turn shot. I'm kidding. You can do that during recess. All right. Here's what I'm talking about. You know, kids don't remember anything I tell them. They remember everything they tell one another. Get the kids teaching one another. Even those of you in this class, you know, how much do you really remember from my lectures? Your brain doesn't remember. You know, brains usually remember. Like if I do songs with you, you remember things that got you to laugh, maybe stories and stuff. But really what helps you the most is when you actually get into a practical activity. So if you ever take the assignment seriously and do something that's actually useful to you, that's how you learn the best. I mean, I can tell you when I took this class, I was just like, you know, requirement. Now that I teach it, I've learned so much more about language acquisition because I'm interested in making it understandable and interesting to all of you. So I really think that's the best way for kids to master any of these things. Routines in the classroom provide the same comfort. Audience is fine. The predictability of movies with their favorite action stars, or, you know, even like watching a soccer game. If you already understand the rules, there's not going to be any surprises. You know what's going to happen next. You don't want to throw a lot of surprises in your ESL students unless you're trying to get them to remember some information. We talked about that earlier. It's always important to review your own instructional delivery. Good ESL teachers are reflective, passionate practitioners, constantly thinking of better ways to reach all of their students. Now, I said many times in the past year that if you really want to become a great teacher, you should watch 500 other teachers. And if you don't have time to go to different schools and different classrooms, maybe you should become a substitute teacher, which is great because you're exposed to lots of different grade levels, schools, things like that. Or watch TeacherTube or YouTube or any of these videos online. There's tons of teachers submitting examples of their teaching methods. And I've always said you should watch as many good teachers as you can. Every now and then it's good to watch a bad teacher. And I like watching tons of movies about teaching. And there is a wonderful book by Roald Dahl called Matilda. If you've not read Matilda, that is the book you need to rush out and buy. Roald Dahl is a wonderful author. It's the reason he's one of the most popular children's authors of all time. Now, there was a movie version of Matilda, and I love the movie as well. The book always is better, but the movie was great. It's directed by Danny DeVito, stars Danny DeVito. But this is the movie version of Matilda, and one of the things I love about Matilda, this is her first day of school. This is an example of a horrible teacher. This is when the principal, the trunchbull, decides to teach them. So this isn't the first day of school. This flip isn't the first day of school. This is just a day that the principal, who's just this evil, evil woman, she takes over the class. And so this is about a 5-minute clip showing you what not to do as a teacher, as Principal Trunchbull teaches this first grade classroom. Enjoy this clip from Matilda.
Thank you.
Can you spell?
So you taught us how to spell a law word yesterday. We can spell difficulty.
You can spell difficulty in your life depended on it.
She taught us with a poem.
A poem? How sweet. What poem would that be?
Mrs. D, Mrs. I, Mrs. N, F, I, Mrs. C, Mrs. U, Mrs. L, Z, Y.
Why are all these women married? Mrs. D, Mrs. I, you're supposed to be teaching spelling. I'm told you.
Secretary of Education. She's perfect for no child left untested. It's unbelievable. Do yourself a favor. Get on Netflix a copy of Matilda. Show it to your kids. I think it's just a wonderful movie. It's a beautiful book. Absolutely one of my favorite books. I love the French books of color. This is odd. All these women marry, you know, and it cracks me up because poetry, I was saying earlier, is one of the most underutilized resources in our classrooms. I love getting my kids talking about poems all the time. I think it's fantastic. Again, poems are underutilized, and they're so much shorter for kids to read. It's a great way to get lots of poems that rhyme. Rhyming is a wonderful way for any kid to learn English, especially if English isn't your first language. It's great. I absolutely love that. I just got an email from CHCH. Thank you for emailing CH. Writes to correct you in person while they are speaking is often offensive. I completely agree, CH. It's rude. It's that person is always like, oh, actually, this is the way to do it. I completely agree with you, CH. You email back anytime.
I'm a big fan of using poetry in the classroom, so I just want to give you a few ideas about how to use poetry in your classroom to get your kids talking about poetry and listening to poetry all the time. I mean, you need to, first of all, surround your students with poetry all around the classroom. That gets them excited about poems. There's all kinds of different types of poems out there, anywhere from a basic rhyme to a couplet to a haiku, acrostics, diamantes, cinquains. There's lots of different types of poems out there. We do chants all the time in my classroom, lots of chants. You gave me a chant earlier. Here's a chant for days of the week. So everybody repeat after me. You gotta do the gestures. The gestures actually help you out. So you go, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, the days of the week. Ahora en español. Domingo, lunes, martes, miércoles, jueves, viernes, sábado. Los días de la semana. Okay, now gibberish. Now, the reason I do that is because one of my favorite things to do as an elementary school teacher is to have yard duty, me supervising 950 children on a playground. And during yard duty, I always have at least three kids that come up to me that have skin in the knee. They're like, and I'm like, you know what, Rogelio? I don't understand gibberish. I can only speak Spanish or English. Please give me Spanish or English. So that's why we do that. So do lots of chants with the kids. I love doing chants. Treasure hunts. I used to come in the room, and I called myself the Palm Hunter. How many like? On the Palm Hunter. Today I'm looking around the classroom looking for a hard cue. The hard cue is extremely rare. Comes to us from Japan. Anybody find me a haiku? Like, choir or something like that. Do that. Again, folks, you know, bring the fun back into the classroom. I see so many people that are teaching, like, the Trunchbull. You know, and it's because of this emphasis on test scores. I mean, it's unbelievable, folks. It's crazy. It's completely crazy. What's crazy is I train teachers around the country, and here's what I tell them to do. Shut your door. Do it your way. I'm so sick. Here are all these scripted reading programs all over the place. You know, have a brain, use it. As a beginning teacher, I understand, you might need some kind of extra help, but we have veteran teachers that are quitting because they're being forced to teach it one specific way when they were an effective teacher beforehand. Again, if you're an ineffective teacher, I say get rid of that teacher, get rid of tenure. You know, who needs tenure? I don't need tenure. Tenure's for teachers that freak out because they're not very good teachers. You know, I'm willing to compete with the next teacher. Come on, let me compete. Absolutely, I'm a big fan of competition. I also think it's ridiculous. Don't get me started. All right, here's what I believe in now. I believe in rewarding good teaching. I believe in rewarding good students. You know, we need to focus on what's working. We keep on focusing on what's wrong. There's so many schools of public education that work. Everybody likes to dump on the public school system and say it's not working. That's a blanket statement. It's a blanket statement. To me, it's offensive when I hear blanket statements like that. It's like saying, it's like making a racial comment. As far as I'm concerned, applying something to an entire group. Come on, folks. I won't move a little bit beyond that, really, folks. Show and share. All kids have different poems from home. Probably heard lots of different tales, nursery rhymes, things like that. Have the kids show and share. I'm a big believer in bringing back show and tell. You might have to rename it standards-based sharing time, but bring back show and tell. I like getting my kids up and talking and listening, and I guarantee you during show and tell, every kid is listening. These human beings are naturally noticing. We want to know each other's business. That's why there's about 10,000 subscribers to the Journal of Reading and 10 million subscribers to People Magazine. Who cares about teaching a kid how to read when we can find out what Sean and Kate's latest problems are in their relationship, all right? So bring back show and tell. Get those kids talking. We want to provide as many opportunities. That's why I have no problem with watching TV clips and movie clips with my kids too. Use all the kids a common experience that now they can talk about. Get excited about something. Interactive poetry wall I have in my classroom. Basically, I have a roll of toilet paper and one kid starts a poem and other kids can continue the poem. I got this idea from going to gas station restrooms. Just about every single gas station restroom I've ever been in has some type of poem etched into that that bathroom stall. So, kids writing that way, post-it poems. I get tons of post-its here. If you ever need post-its, folks,
go to doctor's offices. They get tons of free postage from pharmaceutical companies. Whenever I need something, I do my Joe Friday, go into the office, I'm like, hi, I'm Andy Purcell, inner city teacher. Would you mind donating some postage to me? I mean, because folks, you tell people you're a teacher, you might as well tell them you have cancer. You know, you're a bit of a party, but what do you do? I'm a teacher.
Really? That's great. Tough man.
All right. So I get tons of postage that way. And what I'll do is I have to post it all in my classroom where the kids will practice onomatopoeia. That way, onomatopoeia, these words that sound like words, the noises that they make, you know. So I have a great story about that. My son and daughter, Sean and Kate. Sean is 4 and Kate's 5. And I was reading to them this book in bed called Don't Eat the Teacher. It's about this shark that eats everything. And every time he eats something, he goes crunch, crunch, crunch. And when he was going crunch, 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 I told him, he's like, hey, that's called onomatopoeia. Well, a couple weeks later, my wife's driving the kids in the car. I'm hoping I haven't told you this anecdote before, but I have. I've had just planned on early teacher Alzheimer's. Anyway, the kids are in the car, and my daughter was talking about something. Whenever she's upset, she wants everybody to know, so she was going in the back seat. And so my wife says, Sean, is Kate doing onomatopoeia? And Sean said, no, she's not doing onomatopoeia. She's having a temper tantrum. I love that. I love kids. Absolutely love kids. I'm going to give you a couple other ideas for poetry, but I want to make sure we get to this one other clip. I have a clip from My Fair Lady. I love showing clips from My Fair Lady. Because when we're using poetry, one of the things I like to use are tongue twisters with my kids. And here's a fun scene about Huff and Giff in New Hampshire. It's about a 2-minute clip from My Fair Lady. Enjoy this really brief clip, and then we'll wrap up afterwards.
You see that thing? Every time you pronounce the H correctly, the thing will wave out. Every time you drop your H, the thing will remain stationary. That's how you'll learn that correctly until you go to your own deliverance. You see it this way in the mirror. Now, here we go. In Hartford, Hereford, and Hampshire, salutations hardly ever happen. Now, hear that thing. In Hartford, Hereford, and Hampshire, salutations hardly ever happen.
In Hartford, Hereford, and Hampshire, hurricanes hardly ever happen.
Oh, no, I haven't no ear at all.
Hardly ever.
No, please. Start from the very beginning. Just do this. Go, ha, 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 ha.
Ha, 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 ha.
Go on, go on, go on.
Ha, ha, ha.
I love My Fair Lady. That's fun. Alliteration, giving the kids tongue twisters, things like that. Some other poetry ideas, you know. A lot of my best poetry ideas came from drinking games in college, so I called a long game called the Association Chain, where I'll give the kids the word, and the last letter of my word becomes the first letter of their word. So I'll say, like, orange to the kid, and so that the last letter in orange is E, so their first letter in their word has to start with E, so the kid goes elephant, they look at another kid, and that kid gets a T, so the kid's like truck, to K, to another kid, the kid's like kangaroo, you see how it works. I'll play musical chairs, poetry with the kids, play musical chairs, but when the music stops, the kids sit in their seats, there's a poem in every seat, the kids read before we start the music again. And then, finally, one other thing I used to do with the kids was called Coffee House Nightmares again. I'm also liking to get in the drama into the classroom, too. We should be doing lots of dramatic games with the kids. And I have lots of dramatic games listed in the e-text for all of you to look at. But Coffee House Night, the kids and I would dress up in turtlenecks and berets and invite the parents home over to our classroom. We'd give them coffee and open mic where the kids got to read aloud their own poems. And, you know, I had one boy once, Tyrell. I've always told the kids, you know, you know, there's all kinds of different poems, and if you don't know what kind of poem you've written, just call it free verse, because there's no rules to free verse. So one day, Tyrell gets up there, and it's like, recess. So cool. Free verse. You always have to keep your eyes on the boys. The boys are always trying to find an easy way out. All right, so those are some ideas for poetry. In your e-text, I also have tons of ideas for you on creating lots of drama games for your students. One of the greatest things about using poetry and drama with the kids, it's really easy to differentiate these activities for different students. I showed you earlier with poems, you know, some kids can do simple poems and some kids can do more complicated poems. With drama, you have some kids that have done, that are just doing pantomime, some kids are doing skits that they created beforehand, more advanced kids can even do improvisation. So these are all kinds of different ideas for you. Just remember, when we're trying to facilitate oral language development, speaking and listening, you want to encourage your students to work in groups on motivating projects. I think that the ideas we've been giving have all hit upon that. We want to provide activities with various scaffolds for oral language performance, allowing our ESL students of all ability levels to participate. That's what I was just talking about in terms of differentiation. And we want to focus on fun uses of oral language, reducing the anxiety sometimes associated with using a second language. I believe that school and fun don't have to be mutually exclusive. It does not have to look like the French class classroom in there. And I believe that the more fun kids are having, the more they're actually learning, because we're creating memorable experiences that the kids enjoy. A little bit of joy needs to return into the classroom. We're losing too many great teachers and too many kids who are losing their attention every single day. I want to conclude with a wonderful Italian proverb. It goes like this, folks. It says, from listening comes wisdom, and from speaking, repentance. Nothing like the Italians with a sense of humor, folks. I hope you've enjoyed today. I had a great time. Thank you so much for all your emails. Thank you, Harold, for giving us our lone phone call today. Love taking y'all, folks. Hey, you have a wonderful weekend. And remember, this week, you make a difference each and every day. I'll see you next week, everybody. See you next week.